Welcome to Speechless. We are glad to have you here. We're live from the SEC studios in White Bear Lake, also live in St. Paul over SPNN. A lot of things to discuss. The main thing, there's a bill down in the legislature. Some people call it the Safe Bathroom Bill. That's not the real name. Gender Accommodations Bill, what have you. But we're going to talk about that. Went down and filmed the hearing, have a lot of information to go through. The hearing was an hour, 45 minutes. And guess what? This is an hour show. So we're going to pick and choose from there, but just going to give you the gist of the bill and hear some of the feedback, kickback from some of the legislators down there. I think it was a very nasty confrontation. Representative Grunhagen, who introduced the bill, thought everybody was cordial, but I didn't think that. So you can watch, figure out for yourselves. We're going to show some of the nastiness that took place. All right, but before we get into that, there's an article in your local Lilly newspapers, you know, like the Ramsey County Review. It could have been in this one. But Senator Wiger had a thing about we can all take part in Earth Day and talk about having clean water. Well, it's interesting that he just left it to that narrow focus because Mr. Pollution or Senator Wiger didn't want you as a parent to know that the Matabidi school was built on and right next to a Superfund waste site that is not working right, and fought to make sure that you didn't know about it. So how do you have clean water if you don't know about it? And then how do you, or clean environment? It's not just water. It's the land. It's what you breathe. It's the contaminants coming into the school. It's a mess. The big thing is there are people going to Matamidi schools. The parents of the children need to research this, need to understand what's going on, need to understand the side of the people that are saying there's a problem. The other thing with Mr. Clean Water, refuses to acknowledge that there's a problem with the waste system or the pipes. A bunch of 600,000 gallons went into Lost Lake. Lost Lake's going to White Bear Lake, contaminated that. Is not recognizing the problem that is taking place there. And trying to come up with $600 million solutions when you can do it for $20 million. So, Mr. I Believe in the Environment is kidding you. He's deceiving you. He's trying to trick you to believe that he's concerned about the environment. And he's not concerned about the environment or your kids. At least you should have notice so that then you can make the decision of what to do, which is not taking place. Also in the Ramsey County Review here, Ramsey County agrees to believe communities unite against sexual violence, and that's a good thing. But part of the problem here is they expose in the article is prosecution. And you want to stop sexual violence and prosecute those that commit it, but what you really end up facing is the evidence, that the evidence isn't there, and then you can't move forward. So in my mind, what they're trying to do is trying to set up a situation where you can convict people without evidence. Okay? In other words, the system wants to move towards that. We're going to get you because of politics, you know, and we're going to get you because we just want somebody to be able to accuse you and then you're guilty. And that's what's going on. And you don't get to defend yourself. That's part of what's going on here. And they admit the reality. I don't know what's going on with Choi. County Attorney Choi, he has these statistics about domestic violence that are based on nothing. They're not peer reviewed. And I told him where to go and where the information is. We've done it over and over on this show. But if they're not going to address the issue of female violence, violence against men, then you're not going to deal with the issue. And that is something that just kind of gets in the way of having a solution. Because all of a sudden now, you got to start arresting women for violence. And of course, we see it in the news all the time. Women killing their children, women killing men, women extorting money, women stealing money, robbing banks. You have all this. The point is not that women are worse than men. The point is women are just as bad as men. Okay? And when you want to have this lack of equity, you know, that's the other thing in the news, promoting equity. St. Paul mayor wants equity. Well, you need to have it in all areas. So let's address the behavior. Let's deal with the behavior, and let's deal with the behavior equally, rather than saying some people get a free pass because of their gender. That's going on. Okay. Another article in the Supreme in the news is the U.S. Supreme Court is set to weigh the breath test law. Now, we've talked about Michelle McDonald getting pulled over, and she has done a challenge and is still, my understanding, waiting to do a challenge that she didn't have to do the breath test, one, because there was no alcohol and there's no smell of alcohol and she wasn't drunk. So why should you have to do a breath test? Well, there's somebody else in Minnesota, and the Minnesota Supreme Court had already ruled that, I forget the details on this, but a person decided not to take the breath test, and he challenged that under the Fourth Amendment. You have to have a warrant in order to do that. So that's going to the U.S. Supreme Court, and this individual won. I'm thinking he won in the appellate court and won in the Minnesota Supreme Court. And the other side, the government's challenging that. That's a good news. You know, the Fourth Amendment is important because what you see is you see officers make things up and then you get charged with other things for actually defending your rights. You know, so resisting arrest when you're actually defending your rights. No, I don't have to get out of the car. No, I don't have to take a breath test because it's an illegal search. You know, you're actually defending your right, so they get you on resisting arrest or failure to take a breath test. So it's going to the U.S. Supreme Court, and we'll see what happens there. And then people get all mad at you for challenging the law to see how it is and what our rights are. All right, let's get the, and I actually have a graphic on Del Nathan here. You should see his picture. I don't know if it's 9, 10, or 11, but let's bring that up here. Del Nathan, who was on the 2020 show regarding the Sandra Gerzini Rucki Lost Girls. Well, he passed away the Saturday after the show, the Friday night show. And what people didn't know was that, most people didn't know, was that he was in the hospital and had surgery. And, you know, we got a lot of information about the new health insurance and health insurance doesn't guarantee care, and care doesn't guarantee that you have health insurance. So, and doesn't guarantee the quality of care either. But he made some notes about his care, And it was a mixed bag, you know, of things. But I just think it's, you need to hear this. The care I got up until hours after my surgery was phenomenal. The last day and a half here, the nurses got less compassionate, and the doctors cared less and less about your pain. I wanted to check myself out, but was threatened that my insurance would be notified not to pay my bill. That means he wanted to get out of the hospital. And this happens. No, you got to stay. They won't pay your insurance. Well, that, they tell you that. That's a bunch of baloney. Okay? You have every right to get out of a hospital. Okay? And if you go, yeah, the insurance may not, and they may. But if they're treating you bad at the hospital, get out. Why have the abuse? You know, and sometimes they'll threaten to arrest you. It's just, there's nothing that requires you to stay in a hospital. Nothing. Just leave. Although you can never, okay, they let me suffer last 3 days here. Two out of three nurses were great, although you could never find one when needed. As of today, I still hurt. Nothing is being done, and they won't let me go home. I wouldn't recommend my family coming here, nor my worst enemy. You know, and Dale was kind to his worst enemy. We're going to see some video on him. Nurses and docs are not careful enough and knowledgeable enough of risk of personal dialysis. Now, I'm going to say that wrong, and I don't know that he spelled it right. Which is a real problem with the hospitalists, okay? Because you go in, you know, your own doctor doesn't go into the hospital. You got to use the hospitals that are in the doctor, or you got to use the doctors that are in the hospital, okay? And you have to explain it over and over again to them. You have to do it, or a family member has to, and they don't have the whole picture. It's just terrible. They should let your doctor come into the hospitals, but they don't. So when expressing concerns to staff, they take it the wrong way instead of coming up with a solution to make the patient feel like they are at home. What is the point of coming here if everything they need to get the job done is supplied from the patient's home? Good question. Entry, nasty, terrible service. They can send you home to die. I mean, if they're just going to let you die there, they might as well send you home, you know, and you're trying to leave anyway. Next entry, horrible experience. The service was a long, slow process, and they filled my IV with something I had an allergic reaction from and left me in a room passed out from it for over an hour. Good thing my friend came in to check on me. All right. And so then there was a phone number for United Hospital. United Hospital, we'd like to hear more about the service you received here. Please contact Patient Care Support Services. Tough way to go, but he made the big scene on the news. So let's watch the first video here of Del Nathan. You'll get a flavor of his personality and some comments that were made about him. Nope, that's the wrong video. We want the lower two over there. So, you know, Del was born in Kentucky. Didn't know that. He graduated from the University of Kentucky, had a Bachelor of Arts degree with majors in political science and accounting, and a Bachelor of Law degree, both received in 1957. He completed 7 years of college work in 5 years and paid for his college education through scholarships and concurrent employment. All right, we got the video ready? All right, let's play
that. Dale Nathan, a diminutive 81-year-old who has spent years working as an attorney in custody cases. Dale had his legal license suspended after he refused to reveal where one of his clients was in hiding with her child. He is a fervent supporter of Sandra.
Dale is somebody who believes to the bone that the family courts in Minnesota are corrupt.
All right, there's Dale, and that was the truth. I believe that too. And there are a lot of people that believe the family courts are corrupt to the bone. And so that gave a good picture. David, understand, when he lost his license, this is how it happened. He had a client that would not disclose to Judge Blakely in Dakota County where the child was. And the judge ordered the client to disclose that. And then he ordered Dale Nathan to disclose that. And Dale had no idea where the child was, didn't know anything. Says he, and to this day, said, well, until he died, he said he didn't know where the child was. But the judge then threw him in contempt of court for not exposing client information. You know, there's this attorney-client privilege that you have in communication. And he got thrown in jail for some 9 weeks for not exposing where this mother had taken the child. Dale didn't know, and the mother wasn't there in court. Okay? They had both, my understanding is they had both gone. Well, here's the deal, okay? This Judge Blakely then orders Dale Nathan to say where the child is. Dale says, I don't know. The judge finds him in contempt of court for violation of a court order. Okay? Which you can be in contempt of court for. But what was the court order? Was the court order illegal? Well, the Minnesota courts could care less whether the court order was legal or not. The issue was, it was a court order. You didn't do it. And so they threw him in jail. They took away his license. He appealed all the way to the Minnesota Supreme Court. And they said, no, Dale, you had to tell where the child was. That's attorney-client privilege, and I don't even know. Too bad, you lose your license because you violated a court order. And there's not a single judge that will address that issue. There's not a single judge that will go out there and say, hey, something's wrong here. There's not a single attorney that will say, hey, there's a problem here. And the legislature won't address it. That's corrupt to the bone. Of course, the word corruption means there's some financial gain in it. And maybe there was. Maybe somebody was paying Judge Blakely. Oh, Judge Blakely, by the way, got suspended from the bench for 6 months because he was making referrals in divorce cases to, I believe it was psychologists that were friends of his. And getting kickbacks, from what I understand. Or reduced fees. Something for his own divorce. Reduced fees for his own divorce. 6 months, the Supreme Court suspends him. Doesn't kick him off the bench. Minnesota Supreme Court doesn't care about the how the courts look in this deal. But Judge Blakely ran for re-election. He got ousted in the general election. He made it through to the primary. Fortunately, two people stepped up to the plate and ran against him. By the way, if you're running for judge in the statewide office or in the second judicial district, give me a call. We'll get you squared away and let you know what you need to do to get going. Let's go to the next video. This kind of describes Dale Nathan's personality.
Dale says he knew that the children had already been taken out of Sandra's custody and that by driving off with them, she was breaking the law.
Sandra was busy telling the police she had no idea where the girls had gone, and you knew Sandra was lying.
I thought she was, yeah.
Well, you knew she was because you were in the car with her.
That's true.
Right.
You're right.
So if you knew she was lying about that, why didn't you go to police and say, I know what really happened?
I think Sandra was trying to protect her children. I wasn't going to betray that.
Dale insists he couldn't help even if he wanted to. He doesn't know where Sandra ended up taking the girls.
So, I mean, that is Dale to the bone. I mean, that's a very good description of his personality. What people don't know about Dale, he worked for government, then for private industry, and was a law editor and for a publisher of legal reporters. In 1965, Dale moved to Minnesota, became the chief counsel for a large division of a multinational company that manufactured weapon systems for the military service. In 1978, Dale left that company, went into private practice. Let's see. He also, for 13 years, co-director of the Government Contracts Program and adjunct professor of college law at the University of St. Thomas. 72, Dale was national president of a national organization, the National Contract Management Association. So, and also he was legal counsel, my understanding, for Sperry Univac for a long while. But quite an accomplished person. He helped anybody that needed help. And there's a lot of people that will miss him, and the legal system will miss him. And kind of a question is anybody going to step up into his place and fill the void? Who knows? Okay, let's get to gender accommodations, safe bathrooms, safe locker rooms. There's a bill heard in the House on Tuesday, so we're going to see what that was about. And it's just very interesting, a very good discussion that went on. So we're going to see the first testifier here, Kate Ives, see what she has to say about the bill.
Well, thank you. My name is Kate Ives, and I'm here to share my story and to show you how what is happening with this practice and how it impacts women and children. No one is listening to us. We are being told that we do not matter, that our privacy and safety are not worth protecting. However, I do believe that we also deserve equal rights. We deserve compassion and protection, and therefore we need you to listen to us, stand up for us, and protect us. I want to, before I say anything else, I need to clarify this, because as soon as somebody knows that I am not comfortable with this practice, I am being called transphobic or a hater of trans people or that I want to harm them. None of that is true at all. That is not the case, never has been. Trans people are not the threat. I am trying to be sensitive to their feelings, but I don't believe that I need to relinquish my right to safety and privacy. There are no safeguards in place in allowing biological males into our women's bathrooms and restrooms. This is giving a free pass to countless deviant men to come and victimize, exploit women and children. This is happening. There are cases all over the news. I know you were given some this morning in that folder. I just want to point out the flawed logic. I am not against trans people because I want my safety protected. Over the last summer, I encountered a biological male standing in the women's locker room, watching women shower and typing on his phone. I went to my health club, to the staff members there, to report this, and I was told that they assumed this person is a harmless transgender person, and therefore he has every right to be there. My privacy concerns, my safety concerns, have not even been acknowledged. I thank you for your time.
All right, she brings out her testimony, We're talking about safety and privacy. That's what you're going to hear over and over again, safety and privacy. And so Jim Ballantyne, attorney, he's going to speak next, and he brings up the issue of privacy in the law. Let's hear what he has to say.
Thank you, Madam Chair, committee. My name is Jim Ballantyne. I live in Falcon Heights. I'm a litigator, and I'm a volunteer attorney with the North Star Law and Policy Center. I would like to focus my testimony this morning on the goal of this bill to protect the privacy and health of every student in our state's public schools. This goal of protecting privacy and health of every student is good policy for three reasons. First of all, schools should respect and protect the physical privacy and health of every student entrusted to their care. Bodily privacy is an established constitutional right. Last year, a federal court stated, quote, "Not only is bodily privacy a constitutional right, the need for privacy is even more pronounced in the state educational system," close quotes. The presence of a member of the opposite sex in a restroom or locker room immediately violates the bodily privacy rights of every other person in that facility. It does not matter whether a boy self-identifies as a girl. Our own Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals held that a transgender individual's use of a women's restroom threatened female privacy. Second, Minnesota law already confirms that ensuring single-sex access to restrooms and locker rooms is not discrimination. We are against any type of discrimination. Minnesota law already confirms that it is not discrimination to ensure single-sex access to restrooms and locker rooms. The Minnesota Human Rights Act specifically states already that it is not discrimination in a public accommodation to restrict facility use based on biological sex. This statute will simply back that up. Thirdly, federal courts have confirmed that ensuring single-sex access to restrooms and locker rooms is an important government interest and does not violate Title IX. This statute will not violate Title IX. Title IX does not require what the other side is proposing. And we're asking that you vote yes on this bill. Thank you.
Yeah, it's really interesting that the other side that wants men in the women's bathrooms because it's their choice, they say that the law allows it. Well, it doesn't, okay, but that's part of the argument. So the Minnesota education system, the transgender side is saying, yeah, we get to do this. The law says we get to do this, and it doesn't. Okay, but that's part of the deception and part of how people get away with breaking the law because they just say that it does. Okay, so Representative John Lesh had a response to the lady about name calling, so let's hear what he had to say.
And I would only point out this, Madam Chair, Representative Grunhagen, testifiers, or even not testify, anyone who says they're concerned about being called transphobic or discriminatory or unaccommodating, welcome to the club of how trans people feel. Because those are the folks who have been criticized on one. I would only suggest if you feel that way, you need to develop a tougher skin. If you're concerned about being called transphobic, develop a tougher skin because it's the big kids' table. We're all sitting around. We need to treat people fairly. That's all I'm saying.
You know, and I agree with John Lesh there. Yeah, get a tougher skin. The immature people will be calling names. Okay? And that includes those that may before this gender accommodation bill. Okay? Anybody calling names that's not the, those are the immature people, okay? So let's deal with the issue, the right to privacy and the right to safety. And what are our laws and how, and what is the system? And what rights do you have in your right to privacy? So Marjorie Holston, an attorney, she gives the next legal aspect of a constitutional history on this issue.
Thank you. Marjorie Holston speaking as an attorney, a private citizen, and a parent. Good morning. Thank you for the opportunity to address the committee today in support of House File 3396. I'd like to focus my testimony this morning on the goal of HF 3396 to protect two fundamental rights. Those are, number one, the religious freedom rights of every student in our state's public schools, and number two, the rights of parents to direct the upbringing of their children. The First Amendment to the United States Constitution lists six forms of protected expression, which include respecting the establishment of religion and not prohibiting the free exercise thereof, and also protecting the right of the people to peaceably assemble, which we call freedom of association, which includes the right not to associate with people, including those of the opposite sex, in an intimate setting. The 14th Amendment makes the First Amendment binding on all the states. In addition, Minnesota's Constitution protects religious freedom. Specifically, Article 1, Section 16 of Minnesota's Constitution provides in relevant part the right of every man to worship God according to the dictates of his own conscience shall never be infringed. Minnesota Supreme Court has recognized that the Minnesota Constitution provides even stronger protections for religious liberty than does the U.S. Constitution. In the interest of time, I'm not going to have cites to cases, but I can provide those upon request. The U.S. Supreme Court has recognized that students do not shed their constitutional rights when they enter the school. HF 3396 protects the religious freedom rights of students. Many religious students, including those of Christian, Jewish, and Muslim faiths, believe it is immoral to commingle with members of the opposite sex while engaging in private activities like using restrooms, bathing, or changing clothes. These students are precluded by religious-based modesty principles from sharing restrooms, locker rooms, or shower rooms with members of the opposite sex. Stop a minute. Parents have rights to direct the upbringing of their children, so I'd like to support HF 3396 as a necessary tool to protect the religious freedom rights of students, to protect the rights of parents to direct the upbringing of their children, and to shield schools from lawsuits that they will face for violating these fundamental rights. Thank you for your testimony.
All right, so she laid out the context of religious freedom, issues of modesty in the bill. Let's listen to Representative John Lesch again make some other comments about Representative Grunhagen in even putting this bill out there.
And if there are anyone else presenting this law but you, I would suggest that they were being disingenuous. I would suggest that they're doing it in order to gin up fear for political reasons. But I know you, and I know you actually believe this, okay? And I disagree with you, but in my experience, the people that we have to fear and have to create laws and regulations about, they're the people who have something to hide. They're not the people who present, readily present in a manner that doesn't fit the dominant paradigm. Those are not the people. I was asked, doesn't my 15-year-old daughter have to be concerned about, you know, people in the restroom? And I said, no. I know who she has to be afraid of. We all know who my 15-year-old daughter needs to be afraid of, and she's going to be afraid.
All right, Mike, who does she have to be afraid of if she's going to be afraid? I mean, answer the question. Who is it? Who do you think it is? Since we're all feelings-based, who is it? You know, John Lesch, answer the question yourself. I mean, leave us to speculate as to who it is. In here, you got men that want to go into a woman's restroom, and they shouldn't be afraid of that, okay? And be afraid of those that have something to hide? What's he saying? He's just not very clear here. But to call him disingenuous, and all the other legislators that signed their name to this bill, and wrote, 35 of them wrote a letter to North Carolina, said, hey, we don't agree with what the governor of Minnesota did, you know, and we support your safe accommodations bill. So there's safety for everybody, even the transgender. Okay, and come back, you know, so disingenuous. Okay, so there's John Lesch getting into the name calling. Well, Representative Grunhagen, he doesn't care, you know, but it's not disingenuous. It's Representative Lesch that was being disingenuous, because there's a number of legislators that disagree with John Lesch. Okay, and to answer that, Representative Lohmer had some statements on that issue. Let's hear what she has to say.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you, Representative. Thank you, Representative Grunhagen, for bringing forth this bill. I agree with Madam Chair's statements that this is an important discussion, and a lot of points have been made, Representative Lesch and Representative Schoen, about, you know, being afraid and, you know, what kind of physical harm is going to happen to these individuals that are in these situations. I just want to tell a story. I think probably all of us have had the opportunity and have probably taken the opportunity to go to the state fair in the summer and go to the education building and sit at the House of Representatives booth and talk to folks who come by with concerns. And I just want to tell the story of the day that I was there last summer with several other of my colleagues, and a school teacher from St. Paul, from a middle school, came up to the table very distraught. She was filling out the survey, but she was very, very distraught, and she wanted to know who she could talk to, because in her experience at school, she is seeing, she says, young girls, middle school girls, go into the restrooms oftentimes to get away from boys who are harassing them. And because of the changes that we're seeing now in St. Paul School District policy, that can't be stopped. And these girls have no safe place to go. And so what do we do for these girls? And, you know, physical injury, yes, is one thing. And I don't know how we can prove emotional harm that's happening, but there was a lot of discussion today from a lot of you, emotional discussion and depression and those kinds of things. We care about all children in those situations. And so I'm so thankful that we're having this discussion today with Representative Grunhagen. We do need to address this. And so we haven't solved it maybe today, but I'm really glad that we've had the opportunity to have the discussion. And I told this teacher that I would try to help her address this concern. So thank you very much.
So, Representative John Lesch, is Representative Kathy Lohmer, is she disingenuous? Is Representative Peggy Scott disingenuous? You know, or are you the one being disingenuous? All right, we're going to skip the next video and
okay.
And then go to, just skip the Melissa Coleman, go to Pinto on the federal law. Melissa Coleman, an attorney, explains the federal law as it is and the state law. So she breaks it down in more detail here, but Representative Pinto, an attorney, kind of fires back in order to counteract what she is saying. But the main thing Representative Coleman said, there is no federal law that allows transgenders to go, males and transgenders to go into females' bathrooms. There is none. There's no state law either. Okay, it's not there. Okay, so what is there that the LGBTQ community is grabbing onto to say, hey, we can go do this? And Representative Pinto is saying what that is. So let's hear Representative Pinto's question. In the response,
I'm sorry. Your question was whether federal law requires employers to provide accommodations.
Well, I understand an Equal Employment Opportunity Commission ruled recently that federal sex discrimination law does require that a federal employee who's transitioning be permitted to use the restroom that employee is transitioning to.
Go ahead. Thank you, Representative, for the question. As I indicated in my testimony, the EEOC is prosecuting companies. I think they've prosecuted three companies right now. But the EEOC is basing their interpretation of the law on their own commission's rulings. And this is outside the scope of what Title VII allows, what Congress has clearly stated, what the Eighth Circuit, which is binding here in Minnesota, has clearly ruled, what the Minnesota Human Rights Act says, and what the Minnesota Supreme Court has said. And so, no, the Equal Opportunity Commission's actions in this regard are outside of the scope of their administrative powers.
So here you have the EEOC that's writing their own law, not doing what they're supposed to be doing, and going after law-abiding citizens. These people who are suing and are making the decision to sue law-abiding companies, they need to be fired and they need to be charged, okay, for violating constitutional rights. I mean, this is outrageous. These people need to be exposed. I'll try to find out who they are. But that's what's taking place. Yeah, these companies are getting sued by some lawless government officials. Okay, so let's hear Pinto, Representative Pinto, ask his next question.
So I do understand, though, so the commission has ruled. So right now, though, the commission's ruling, you've got this federal requirement. On the flip side, this would impose a state prohibition. So I guess one concern I have, Representative Brunhagen, is the conflict between those two, but also, as I understand it, in that area, if an employer wants to permit their employee to use a particular restroom, all the fellow employees are fine with this. Perhaps they want to be able to hire a particularly talented employee, whatever else it is, all the sort of things that I think folks on the other side often discuss in the free market, wanting employers to be able to do this. This would, in fact, prohibit that. So it goes from a federal requirement to, in fact, a state prohibition. Is that right, Representative Brunhagen?
Representative Brunhagen, or testifier?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you for the question, Representative. From a legal standpoint, I'll let my attorney comment on that particular question.
Go ahead. Currently, the state of the law says that employers have the option to designate bathrooms based on biological sex or based on gender identity access. This bill would require that all employers, do designate bathrooms based on biological sex. I think the idea being that the rights of privacy that are exalted in the Constitution and in our current law are so pervasive and so important that employers should not put employees at risk of not having their privacy honored in their workplace setting. And so this bill would make it a requirement for employers. In answer to your question.
All right, so here's the deal. Target, they're going out and saying, hey, transgenders, you can use whatever bathroom you want. Well, Target's going to get a lawsuit for violating somebody's right to privacy. Okay, so good going, Target. It works on both ends. So do you have the right to privacy? Maybe you don't. You don't have that. We'll see later if you do or not. Okay, let's go with the next Pinto question. Representative Pinto. All right, it's not playing. Now, there's one of them I had started later, and that could be it. So just play it from where it is. Huh? Oh, just play the next one then.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, I will take at face value, as Representative Lesh did, that Representative Brunhagen's concerns. We've spoken previously, and I do take it that face value is concerns about safety of his family and others. I have experience, Madam Chair, prosecuting sexual violence, domestic violence, and I'm aware that, as Representative Sherwin's questions were getting to, people who are transgender are far more likely to be the victims of discrimination, to be the victims of physical violence, to be the victims of sexual violence than are other people in society. And I think what we need to be doing is moving towards having more protections against discrimination rather than less. So I guess my last question, Madam Chair, then, relates a little bit to a comment that was made. I guess I was out of the room, but I heard my understanding is a comment that And what is in the head of individuals who are transgender doesn't change what other people see in their exposed bodies. And what I'm trying to understand is where, I've been in bathrooms all my life. There's not a lot of exposed bodies, actually, as it turns out. So I'm just trying to understand. What exactly is the concern here, Representative Grinhagen, that causes us to, in fact, be concerned that transgender individuals who, as we heard so passionately from the final testifier, simply try to use a bathroom of that person's choice, and in fact is in a spot of really not being able to use either one. And perhaps, Madam Chair, I'll just withdraw this as a question, but just express my deep concern. What we should be doing is advancing protections against discrimination for transgender people rather than taking them away. So I move on to the bill.
Representative
Applebaum.
We have just a couple minutes left,
yep.
And we have two questioners left.
Okay, Representative Pinto, you described my bill perfectly. Okay, that's what my bill does. It allows for the constitutional right of privacy and protection for gay, straight, and transgender. Your commentary fits my bill perfectly because we're trying to protect conflicting constitutional rights in a way that accommodate each group of people, okay, including transgenders. And that's what the bill does. So thank you for that wonderful commentary on my bill.
All right. And that's what Representative Pinto didn't get. You know, he doesn't understand this bill. First of all, he tries to keep the issue on bathrooms. You know, if you go to a gas station, most bathrooms are single stall. There's no issue going on. Okay, you go in, you lock the door, nobody else comes in. A lot of restaurants, fast food restaurants, are that way. You know, single stall, you're in there alone, no issue going on. But locker rooms, facilities, you know, workout facilities or schools, you know, YMCA, you know, those type of places, those are not. I mean, the locker rooms are to be private with the same sex, the same biological sex. That's what's going on there. And so there are exposed bodies. I mean, to try to diminish this to say there isn't very many, baloney. That's not true. It depends on the situation. Okay? So you have your right to privacy, right? Don't you? Don't you people think you have the right to privacy, especially in a locker room? Maybe you don't. Okay. Representative Schoen then has some comments. Let's play his about, does this bill really prevent rape?
Madam Chair, so, I mean, from a couple pieces that I've heard and when you talked about some of the handouts that you gave, points out a lot about sexual predators and rape. I mean, do you feel that this is going to prevent rape in public restrooms and locker rooms? Is there a basis of a goal there?
Representative
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you for that question, Representative Schoen. I think when you allow opposite sex people to use showers, dressing rooms, and other public accommodations, it sends the wrong message to a person who has a tendency towards bad behavior towards opposite sex people. And again, I provided documentation in your packet to that effect, where a sexual predator, Ray Witherspoon, used this his defense after entering a female restroom with young girls in it, that he used gender identity as his defense. So there is instances, I think, by allowing this and having the Minnesota Department of Education promote this in our schools, that we're sending a green light to some of these individuals to make those types of entries into opposite sex facilities.
All right. Well, yeah, of course it will help prevent it. Okay, you don't set up a situation. Why do you think we have separate bathrooms for men and women now? It's to help prevent that or to help any other type of sexual assault. It doesn't have to be the extreme area of rape. Okay, it could be other things like taking pictures, right? You're in a locker room. Nobody can take pictures of you and your naked body legally. You know, can they? All right. Representative Schoen, this is the theological question of the day. Representative Dan Schoen asks it. And we're going to see if you got the answer, the right answer. Of course, I have the right answer, but let's watch this next video.
I want to point out a couple statistics. Sexual assault, and you had a testifier provide statistics on sexual assault related to this bill. So, I mean, obviously there's a link that some people believe that having transgender people in a bathroom is going to increase the incidence of rape. But let's...
I respectfully disagree.
Well, I'm just saying that you had testifiers point that out. So that's what I'm hearing. And I think a lot of people in the world hear that too and believe that because that causes fear. 82% of sexual assaults are caused by non-strangers. That means it's someone that you know. And, you know, Representative Grunhagen, I'll end with this. We believe everybody in this room are God's children, right? Representative Grunhagen, I'm going to go back to Representative Steve Simon. This is not original to me. But how many gays, lesbians, bisexuals, transgender people must God create before we accept them?
All right. Bogus, bogus question. Unbelievable. And any of you theologians out there, feel free to call in, give your answer. Of course, we're running out of time, so don't call in here. Here's the answer to this. And here's how they go and change the reality of the situation. For example, all God's children, right? That's wrong. We are not all God's children. Okay? Here's the truth. We are all created by God. That's the biblical perspective. If Representative Dan Schoen wants to talk Bible, get it right. We're all created by God, okay? But that doesn't mean we are all God's children because not all walk after God or receive Him or walk in His ways. Those are called children of darkness, people who do bad things, okay, who violate people's right to privacy and et cetera and stuff like that, who rape people, who steal, who lie, okay, who harm the widow and the orphans. Okay, here's what the Bible says on who is God's children. But to as many as receive Him, meaning Jesus, God, to them He, God, gives the right to be called the children of God, even to those that believe on His name, not born of the flesh, or the will of man, but the will of God. Okay? The children of God are those that receive God, receive His ways, who believe in Him. That means they trust Him to obey Him. Okay? That's a child of God. So, Representative Schoen, are all people children of God? No. Not on any way, imaginable way, can you say all people are children of God. So, when Representative Simon, now Secretary of State Simon, goes out and says, how long or how many years will it take? I forget what the statement was, for us to recognize that God creates transgender children, that these are God's children. It's going to take a long time. And God's not going to accept it either because He says so. Okay, and if you, that's the deception. So Representative Schoen, name calling, the deceiver, okay, name calling. Well, I laid out why it is. But you're being deceptive in the issue of you don't know the theology behind the Bible, and you try to use it to deceive people, which is bad news. Okay, let's see, we got one last. Go to the second to last one, Hillstrom, no right to privacy. This is interesting. Got to play that one.
The second thing that I want to say is there's been discussion about how some folks might want to record people who are in the restroom and distribute. those images. Well, in Minnesota, we actually had a court who said, you have no reasonable expectation of privacy in a locker room. And if you are changing out in the open, you are free to be recorded. I actually have House File 1433 to address that issue. So even if someone of the same gender records you in a locker room, you have no reasonable expectation of privacy. That is the law today in Minnesota. So I think this bill is wrong for Minnesota. I think that this is discrimination. I think there is no place for discrimination in Minnesota, and I think it's wrong.
Well, my question to, as we're closing out here, to Representative Hillstrom is, because a district court judge says that, doesn't make it law. Was this in the appellate court? Well, that those justices are violating all of the federal laws, that you have no reasonable right to privacy inside a locker room. You know what? Baloney. So I'm going to follow up. I'm going to call Deb Hillstrom, find out what that case was, who the judges were, and that legislature should impeach them. Okay, for violating the law and violating their oath of office. Oh, guess what? Judges don't have to take an oath of office. They don't have to follow the Constitution. Oh, I forgot about that. How do we hold them accountable? I guess we don't. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week. And go to Speechless on SpeechlessMN on YouTube. And you can watch this show or tell your friends to watch the show. Also, the whole hearing is on the legislative website, but soon it will be up on SpeechlessMN, probably within a couple days, so you can watch it there. All right. God bless.